by His grace again for fire. We will shout
Greetings. I welcome you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you from God the Father. Our call to worship this morning comes from Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 through 12. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." We have gathered here today to worship the one who is seated on the throne. We have gathered to worship the one with whom we will one day join with peoples from all nations, all tribes, and all languages in worship. Let us pray. Lord, may this time that we have spent here today, gathered in worship of you, prepare us to join with that great choir that will praise your name, the great multitude from all nations, from all peoples, from all tribes, from all languages. And Lord, may your presence here among us shape us to be your faithful people, welcoming those from other nations and tribes and languages even now. Amen. And now receive this benediction. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We hold it together. What a day! Love that you have given us. Lord, we just want to love each brother and sister.
Has brought us together, melting our hearts as one. By God's Spirit we are united, one through His blessed Son. We are one in a bond of love. We are one. Now, dear Lord, we join in worship. Thank you for all you've done. Thank you for the love you gave us. Thank you for making us one. We are one in the bond of love. We are one.
Word of the Lord from Galatians 3, verses 23 through 29. Before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until the earth that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came, that we might be justified by faith. Now that this faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Every promise we can make.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever.
Well, it is wonderful to be in the house of the Lord together this morning. What an honor it is to be able to be here to worship the holy name of our God. I do want to make just a few announcements. First of all, I'd invite you to look around. We are missing several of our church family members this morning. Some are traveling, some are ill, some are just not feeling comfortable coming back yet, and that's perfectly okay. But I would encourage you, just look around, see who's not able to be with us this morning, and I would invite you to reach out to one of those people this week. Send them a card, a text, give them a phone call. Just let them know that we are thinking of them, we love them, and we are praying for them. So I would just invite you to do that as you go throughout your week. We have a pretty busy week in the life of St. Paul's this week and many opportunities to be involved. We are so excited for our 9th through 12th grade teens. They are leaving for church camp in the morning. So I would invite you, as they come to mind this week, be praying for them. James, Serena, and Cicely are going to teen camp. And we are praying that not only would they have a really fun week together, but that it would be a week when they grow deeper in knowledge and love of God. And that as they come back to us on Friday, that they would have a deeper love for God in their hearts, and they would know more fully what it means to be loved by God. So please be praying for these three teens as they go to church camp this week. Tomorrow evening, July 12th, we will be having a young adult small group at 6:30 p.m. at Pastors Daniel and Colleen's home. We are going to be continuing our study through the book of Romans. So if you are a young adult, and we are not putting an age on this, so if you consider yourself a young adult and would love to be a part of that, we would love to have you. We share a meal together at 6:30, and the Bible study follows. So we would love to have you for that. On Wednesday, we are going to have our Bible study up here at the church at 6:30 p.m., so we would love to have you here. And then Saturday, July 17th, we are going to have our July church board meeting from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. Now, this will be a little bit of a special board meeting. It's a little lengthier than our usual board meetings, but that's because it's going to be a time in which we are going to be vision casting and dreaming together about God's plans for the future of St. Paul's. And so we would invite you, please be in prayer for this board meeting. I know many of you have been praying throughout the month of June for this, but as it comes to mind this week, continue lifting up our board members that God would give us wisdom and discernment as we try to discern what God has in store. We believe that God has great things in store for this church family, and we are so excited to be a part of the work that God is already doing in this community and in our world. And then if you are a delegate, or if you would just like to attend, reminder that the Kansas City District Assembly is coming up July 20th through 22nd, so that is next Tuesday through Thursday. We'll have a Tuesday night service. The NMI and NYI convention will be on Wednesday the 21st. And then the business day will be all day Thursday, 8 to 5. And then, of course, the special ordination service will take place on Thursday at 7 p.m. So if you are able to be there, we would love to have you there. It's going to be a wonderful time together as we celebrate the work that God is doing on the Kansas City District. So I'm going to invite Pastor Levi to come and share God's word with us this morning.
Thank you, Pastor Rebecca. Well, grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As always, it's good to be with you on this Sunday. We're continuing in our series in the book of Acts. We'll be in Acts chapter 10, and we're going to read all 48 verses, which I know you're thrilled about. But it's hard to dissect this without getting the whole picture of what's happening, and I think it's all important to get an idea as we read it together. Starting in verse 1, it reads, "In Caesarea there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion of the Italian cohort, as it was called." That's Rome. He was a devout man who feared God with all his household. He gave alms generously to the people and prayed constantly to God. One afternoon, about 3 o'clock, he had a vision in which he clearly saw an angel of God coming in and saying to him, "Cornelius." He stared at him in terror and said, "What is it, Lord?" He answered, "Your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa for a certain Simon who is called Peter. He's lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea." When the angel who spoke to him had left, he called two of his servants and a devout soldier from the ranks of those who served him. And after telling them everything, he sent them to Joppa. About noon the next day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat, and while it was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw the heavens opened and something like a large sheet coming down, being lowered to the ground by its four corners. In it were all kinds of four-footed creatures and reptiles and birds of the air. Then he heard a voice saying, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "By no means, Lord, for I've never eaten anything that is profane or unclean." The voice said to him again, a second time, "What God has made clean, you must not profane." This happened 3 times, and the thing was suddenly taken up to heaven. Now, while Peter was greatly puzzled about what to make of the vision that he had seen, suddenly the men sent by Cornelius appeared. They were asking for Simon's house and were standing by the gate. They called out to ask whether Simon, who was called Peter, was staying there. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Look, 3 men are searching for you. Now get up, go down and go with them without hesitation, for I have sent them." So Peter went down to the men and said, "I am the one you're looking for. What is the reason for your coming?" They answered, "Cornelius, a centurion, an upright and God-fearing man who is well spoken of by the whole Jewish nation, was directed by a holy angel to send for you, to come to his house and to hear what you have to say." So Peter invited them in and gave them lodging. The next day he got up and went with them, and some of the believers from Joppa accompanied him. The following day they came to Caesarea, and Cornelius was expecting them and had called together his relatives and close friends. On Peter's arrival, Cornelius met him and, falling at his feet, worshipped him. But Peter made him get up and said, "Stand up. I'm only a mortal." And as he talked with them, he went in and found that many had assembled, and he said to them, "You yourselves know that it is unlawful for a Jew to associate with or to visit a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone profane or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without objection. Now, may I ask why you sent for me?" Cornelius replied, "4 days ago, at this very hour, at 3 o'clock, I was praying in my house when suddenly a man in dazzling clothes stood before me. He said, 'Cornelius, your prayers have been heard, and your alms have been remembered before God. Send, therefore, to Joppa and ask for Simon, who is called Peter. He's staying in the home of Simon, a tanner, by the sea. Therefore, I sent for you immediately, and you've been kind enough to come. So now all of us are here in the presence of God to listen to all that the Lord has commanded you to say.' Then Peter began to speak to them, 'I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good things and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the 3rd day and allowed him to appear, not to all people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And then they invited him to stay for several days. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Gracious God, would you even now speak to us by the power of the Holy Spirit, that we might, like Peter, in our hunger, hear you. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, the book of Acts is the story of the church, and it is the story of the Spirit. It's the story of the church trying to figure out what the Spirit is doing. And it always seems like the Spirit is just beyond where they're at any given moment, drawing the church into a new kind of life, a new way of being. And the church always seems to be sort of faltering along, like they're running down a hallway with a dimly lit flashlight, trying to figure out if there's any turns, where to go, but just on the edge of that vision of the light is a path that is unknown, yet unknown. Like the wind, the Spirit seems to blow, and they can tell that the Spirit is blowing, but where it's blowing and how it's blowing is a bit of a mystery. If you start out in the very beginning of Acts, as we've gone through, you will notice that the Spirit is constantly expanding the vision of who is allowed to be part of this kingdom of God. Who is allowed to be part of this community of faith? Who is allowed to be together? God is constantly knocking down these barriers, opening doors, and changing the landscape that had been the life of Israel up until this point. If you go back in the story of Israel, the way that holiness is sort of conceptualized often is this sort of building of a wall that would allow for everything within that wall to stay holy, but everything outside of that wall that was profane and unclean had to stay out there. It was all about separation, maintaining that separation and distance and division, because what is profane, what is unclean, can potentially tarnish and taint that which is made holy. It's this constant balance of worrying about how the clean may be made unclean. And so there's all sorts of rules and regulations as to what can be made clean, how to keep things clean. For instance, within the life of the temple, there are concentric circles, you might say, these inner and outer courts. And the closer you are to the Holy of Holies, the more insider that you are. In fact, there's only one person that can even go into the Holy of Holies, and that's only once a year, and that's the high priest. Outside of that is the circle of priests who are there to regulate the life of Israel in its worship. They are constantly about the holy things of God and being precarious about making sure that things are constantly cared for and clean. And then outside of that, the temple and the courtyard of the people. And then outside of that, the courtyard of the Gentiles. So that you move from the most holy of holy further and further out to the most profane. It's all about these divisions that maintain the life of the holy, so that the holy is never tainted. And so you even have all sorts of regulations about who is allowed in what space. For instance, eunuchs. Eunuchs are not allowed in the temple. They are considered unclean, unholy, and so they are not allowed in the temple space. But in the book of Acts, all of a sudden, a eunuch becomes one who follows God and is one who is able to communicate the very life and holiness of God. He's reading the scripture of Isaiah and asks, do you understand what you're reading? Well, how can I understand if nobody will tell me? Everybody keeps me at a distance. How can I learn if no one will teach me? And Philip sits down and begins to explain that the one whom Isaiah is talking about is the Christ. And Christ has welcomed him in. Strange that the life of Israel would maintain all these regulations of holiness, but now those walls are being brought down and a eunuch is allowed to enter into the holy life of God's people. This is strange territory, uncharted territory. We see how God is going to the outsiders, to those who seemingly are always outside of the life of this holy faith. The deeper divisions, for instance, like Paul. Paul, who is a keeper of the holy. He is somebody who has been taught from his very life that holiness is everything. To the point that anybody who would threaten that holiness must be killed. Stephen is stoned for speaking blasphemy. Saul is one who is all about holiness and maintaining those boundaries. And God meets him on the road to Damascus and says, why are you persecuting me? For Saul, this is news, because Saul has never been one to try to persecute God. In fact, what Saul is trying to do is maintain the holiness of the community, trying to maintain and hold on to that which is clean and pure and good. He wants to preserve it. And yet he finds that on this road to Damascus, he encounters one who says, that is not my way. And then we get to the story of Peter. Peter, who is just as much concerned about living a holy life, encounters a Gentile, somebody who was considered outside of the life of the faith community, outside of the life of God, the Gentiles. It's unlawful to even encounter them. And yet, God is doing something really strange, unexpected. And Peter is finding himself in uncharted territory. Too often, the church has used its scriptures as a way of maintaining boundaries about who is in and who is out. And it may be the case that the Spirit is often acting in disruptive kinds of ways in which we need to hear scripture again in new light. That separation is not always holiness. In fact, what God may be doing in the life of holiness is all about joining. I mean, Jesus gets into all sorts of trouble in his life and ministry, does he not? Because he is always violating the Sabbath, violating those rules and regulations that were set down to maintain a life of holiness. But Jesus has this weird idea about holiness, that holiness is contagious. That it can actually, disrupt the profane, the unclean. That holiness is more like the leavening working itself out in the bread than evil and uncleanness are. That holiness is a powerful force in the world, far more powerful than the brokenness in it. Of course, in our world, we are often fearful, worried, anxious kinds of people, and no less in the church. We are constantly worried about how the fellowship might be tainted, how it might be disrupted. We worry in our culture about how things are sort of pervading the church, and we begin to think that holiness is something that we have to protect at all costs. Hold on to it. Protect it. Instead of understanding that holiness has the capacity to transform that which we imagine to be unclean. Cornelius is a centurion. He is a worker of the state, if I could say it that way. He is somebody that is caught up in the life of empire. The Roman Empire operates as if it is God, as all empires do. It is an empire that has maintained its hold by violence. It is an empire that has constantly taken ground at any cost. It is a community that sees its life based on who is in and who is out. That is the life of the Roman Empire. You either have power or you don't. And if you want to maintain your power, you constantly have to remind others that your power is absolute, that your power cannot be hindered, that you are under the rule and reign of Rome, regardless of what your opinion about that is. And Cornelius is one who is caught up in that life. He is a centurion. He is the one who does the bidding of the state. But what is interesting is that Cornelius is a troubled person, in that while he is caught up in the life of empire, he is also somebody that recognizes that there are limitations to what empire can actually do. He is at a tension, at a crossroads. It says that he constantly gives alms. In other words, he has seen what Rome can do. And what is left in the wake of Rome is often those who are most destitute and broken by the systems that Rome inhabits. That the powerful become more powerful while the powerless continuously are trampled underfoot. And he gives alms because he recognizes that this is not right. He is a generous person. He wants to do something about making things right. And not only is he a person who is generous, but he seems to be a person of prayer. That there is this deep kind of hunger in him that power cannot assuage. There is a deep hunger in him that all the wealth in the world cannot satisfy. And he recognizes that there is something deeper and broader and higher. And thus he goes to the one thing that he can: prayer. Prayer is the place where hunger reaches out beyond itself, because it recognizes that hunger cannot be satisfied by bread alone. Hunger cannot be satisfied by what we attain. It cannot be satisfied by the power that we inhabit. It cannot be satisfied by anything other than what St. Augustine says is God. That in our lives, in our very being, is this emptiness that can only be filled by the presence of God. And Cornelius is reaching for anything that will fill that hunger. He's reaching out for something beyond himself, beyond the power of empire that promises everything and yet delivers nothing but death. There's somebody else who is also reaching out into prayer, beyond himself. Somebody who has often been quite inundated with his own inner life, Peter. He is somebody that is constantly getting in his way, it seems like. Even to the point where he betrays his friend and his Lord. But Peter has encountered the risen Christ. And it has left something in him that cannot be satisfied by anything other than Christ. He's praying as he's waiting. It says that while he's praying, he becomes hungry. And while food is being prepared, he goes even deeper into the life of prayer. Peter, like Cornelius, is on a particular journey of hunger. Hunger that can only be satisfied by the one who is the bread of life. Now, Peter knows who that bread is. And he is going back to that well, to that water that can satisfy the deepest thirst of his being. That's where Peter is. Up on a roof, in solitude, listening and waiting in a life of prayer, and experiencing the hunger that prayer is all about. Prayer is not simply answering that hunger, but prayer is going deeper into that hunger that pursues God. While he's waiting, and he goes into this, what they say is a trance, what he goes into this deeper aspect of prayer, suddenly he's given a vision of this sheet, a blanket, coming down out of heaven, lowered by the four corners. It's this sheet that seems to be expansive, covering everything, like the four corners of the world, as it would have been understood at that time. This thing that covers everything, blankets everything. And as Peter watches the sheet begin to spread and unfold before him, he sees something that makes him shudder. It's revolting. It's vile. It's disgusting. It's the thing that he would not anticipate seeing in his life of prayer. He sees all sorts of creatures that are caught up in the sheet. All the kinds of animals that you can eat, and all the ones that you can't. There's the clean animals and the unclean. But then he hears a voice that he does not expect to hear. God says, "Peter, get up, kill, and eat." I don't know if Peter's gag reflex happened at that point, but I imagine it did. Have you ever tried to eat something that you just know that your body tells you, "I cannot eat this at all"? For me, it was always meatloaf. Imagine this meatloaf coming down on a sheet and being told, "Levi, you must eat this." "Oh Lord, no. I can't do that." My body would revolt against that. My stomach would churn, and it would not stay down. I can't stomach that. For those that love meatloaf like my wife, I apologize. But for Peter, this is something that his body is revolting against. "No, Lord. I have never done anything like that. I have never put anything unclean to these lips. Never would I do such a thing." For him, it is a matter of faith. "God, I have been faithful all of my life. I would never do anything like this." Think of all the things that you would never do. "God, I would never, ever do that. I would never compromise my faith, my life with you. I would never compromise it in that way." That is quite a faithful response. For in the Old Testament, it tells you, "You do not eat these things. Otherwise, holiness might be compromised." This happens not only once, but three times. Over and over and over again. Peter probably feels like he's being tested. Maybe kind of like when he heard the rooster crow three times. "Didn't we see you with that man?" "Oh no. No, I'm not one of them. I'm almost certain that I saw you with him in the garden." "No, that wasn't me." "Your voice sounds like you're one of them." "You got it wrong." Three times Peter denies Jesus. I wonder if that comes back up in his mind as he hears this voice telling him to kill and eat that which is unclean. But by the third time, Peter has come to this realization as the voice tells him, "Do not call unclean what I call clean." There has been this uprooting, this sort of deconstruction of everything that Peter has known up to this point. What God has called Israel to be and to do. Now Peter is experiencing something that just seems to run exactly counter to that. "Do not call unclean what I call clean." As Peter is sitting there, maybe he's breathless, sweating, worried. Maybe he just misheard, trying to figure out what exactly this vision is telling him. What does this mean? He hears the voice again and says, Peter, there's three men that have come to find you. I sent them. Go with them. So Peter goes down. He meets these three men. He asks them what they're here for. Our master Cornelius sent us to get you so that he might hear everything that God has given you to say to him. They stay the night. The next day they leave and go to Cornelius. Peter isn't expecting an audience with the centurion, but what he finds is there's an audience. His whole family's there. Everybody is gathered to hear what Peter has to say. Peter says, truly I know now that God doesn't show favoritism to anybody. God doesn't show partiality to anyone. What is it that you would have me say? What am I doing here? Cornelius says, we want to know what God has given you to say. And Peter begins to tell the story of Jesus. That in Jesus, the holy life of God was not one that said, you are separated from me. Instead, it was a life that joined us in our brokenness. And we killed him. And yet, God raised him to new life. And in that life, we have all been made whole. In that life, the very life of God has been joined with humanity and brought in all of humanity. Every single person has not been left out, has not been excluded, has not been dismissed. No, that's the work of empire. Empires exclude and push out. The kingdom of God is not that kind of empire. It is the kind of empire that is the welcoming arms of God, welcome for anybody, everybody, regardless. Do not call unclean what I have called clean. God shows no partiality, no favoritism. For God's love is an expansive love that cannot be exhausted. It is like that sheet. It covers all the boundaries of the creation. And everything that is gathered up in that sheet, in the very life of God, clean, unclean, or otherwise, God looks on it with the very love of God and says, this is mine. And what is mine, I have made clean. Do not call unclean what I have called clean. Peter experiences the work of the Spirit that is drawing him into a new future he would never have anticipated. But it also seems like the Spirit is behind Peter, shoving him into that future as well. So that the very life of God is both wooing Peter and blowing Peter into that new future as well. That God is in the front of this before Peter ever arrives, and God is with Peter as he's trying to figure out what this looks like. Because it is new and he wasn't expecting it, and it doesn't seem like this is what God does. At least based on previous experience, at least based on what the scriptures have said, this does not seem to make any sense other than it seems like the Spirit of God is moving in this direction and watching the breath of God, the wind of God that is moving the trees of history. This seems to be where the Spirit of God is at work. We can see that based on the kinds of things that we see evidenced in the life of the Spirit. As Peter begins to tell and give testimony to the life of Jesus, things begin to happen in this community that have listened to him. All of a sudden, it seems like the Spirit has descended in that place. And like Acts, in the very beginning of Acts, where the Spirit comes on the disciples and they begin to proclaim the work of God and all creation, and everybody understands in their own language, all of a sudden, Cornelius' household begins to demonstrate that same Spirit. There's something that is consistent with what God has done here as what God is doing here, although it is very different than what we anticipated. We didn't expect it to look like this. And yet it seems clear that the fruit of the Spirit is at work and is evidenced here. In fact, Peter says, well, who's going to withhold water from this? Let's bless it and let's baptize. For what God has done, we can't deny it. There's clear, clear evidence that what the Spirit is doing here is the same that the Spirit has been doing with the church all along. I'll be honest. The book of Acts has been very, very difficult to preach. Because I'm constantly wondering, how is the Spirit out ahead of us? Where is the Spirit pushing us, blowing us into new territory that we would never have imagined? I don't take that lightly, because when we start talking about the new territory that the Spirit may be blowing us into, sometimes that means we have to leave the comfort of where we've been, kind of like Peter. It may look entirely different than what we expected. It may even include people that we never anticipated being part of our life together. And that is a difficult place to be, because it is often uncharted territory that we're not exactly sure how to navigate. And we would much rather stay in the kind of territory that we're familiar with, because we've navigated that before, and it's easier, and it's safer, and there's less disruption. But if we want to be in step with what the Spirit is doing, sometimes the Spirit is leading us into new kinds of territory that is disrupting our life together, not so that chaos is created, but that new opportunities to understand the life of God are being created in our midst. And that the welcoming arms of God might be demonstrated through our lives together, that the love of God has no partiality. To the down and out, that we would not give the time of day if we saw them on a sidewalk. God says, I've made clean. To those that we have divisions against, whether we would call them Republicans or Democrats, liberals or conservatives, God welcomes. And besides, those categories are too small to capture God. Those categories get blown up. And all of a sudden, we are sitting here in the midst of people that we would normally not have anything to do with, because we so vehemently disagree. And yet God says, do not call unclean what I have called clean. The people that are in different socioeconomic statuses, people from different countries or backgrounds, people from the rough side of the tracks or the good side of the tracks, people that we do not see any way that God could redeem that person, good Lord, God says, yes. Do not call unclean what I have called clean. For God's love does not show partiality. I'll be honest. It's hard to speak out of this text, because I don't know exactly where the Spirit is blowing us. Part of the reason I wear this, it's not just because I like liturgical robes. It comes from Matthew's gospel, where it talks about my yoke is light and my easy is burden. Excuse me, my burden is easy. But it is still a burden. It is still a burden, a joyful burden. But part of what it means for me to come and preach every Sunday is that I'm constantly on the edge of what the Spirit is doing, and I'm not exactly sure what that looks like. And it also means that sometimes what the Spirit is calling us to be and to do is going to challenge in some really difficult ways. And the conversations that might come out of that may be difficult and painful, and who knows what will lead out of that. But here's what I am sure. I'm sure that the Spirit who leads us into new territory is the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. And that same Spirit is in the work and business of raising new life in dead places, so that the dead places no longer have to be fearful places. They can be places where the Spirit meets us. Too often we have used these texts to judge others rather than to join them. I'll say that again. Sometimes we have used our faith to judge others rather than to join them in the way that Jesus has joined us in our brokenness. Peter would have written Cornelius off, would have judged him unclean and therefore unworthy of God's affection. Peter learns a new way of being in the world as a disciple of Christ, that he is to join them. He sits down and eats with them, which is unlawful. He sits there and he joins them in life. And he testifies to what God has done in his life. He doesn't judge them. He doesn't castigate them. He loves them. And in Peter joining with them, loving them where they're at, the love of God is made manifest in their presence, in their midst. So here's the question for us. Who are the people that God is calling us to join? Not to judge, to join. Who are the people that we would write off? Who are the people that we would call unclean? Who are the people that we would see as unholy, undeserving, unworthy? Who are those people? Do not call unclean what God has called clean. For God's love is not partial. That's really good news for us too. That's really good news for us too. God's love is not partial towards me or you. And as such, the gift we have been given is a gift to be given back, to be given away. The gift we have been given is a gift to be given away. It is not something that can be exhausted. It's not something that can even surprise God when we do it, for God was already there to begin with. In these days, we'll be talking with our board about where do we head? What's next? How do we do life together in a way that is pleasing to God, that gives glory to Christ, that allows us to be the community that God has called us to be in this time and in this place? But that doesn't mean it's just a conversation for our board. This is a conversation for us as a community. This is the work of prayer. And so we would invite you again, as we enter into these conversations, that you would join us in prayer, and that there would be a deep hunger to know God. And I think that deep hunger, as we engage in prayer, will also lead us in joining with others in our community, our families, and that it would all be done for the glory of God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are thankful for the ways that your love continues to seek us out. That it's often unexpected where you're leading us. We're not always sure what to do when we get there. And yet, Lord, we ask that you would give us ears to hear the new song of creation that you're making in our midst. Holy Spirit, come, so that the hunger in us may be filled and overflowing with your love and your mercy, that we might join with those whom you have called clean, that we might join with those whom you love, that we might join with those who suffer and are left out, and that they may experience the love of Christ through us. We know that we can't exhaust that love, God. There's nothing that we can do that would exhaust your love. And so may it be poured out of us like a thanksgiving offering. Help us right now to begin to see with eyes that are new, like Peter. To see the world around us as something that you love deeply and have joined. That we might see the life of holiness not as one of just simply separating our lives out from everything that seems troublesome and problematic, but that holiness actually leads us into the places where brokenness exists. Because we trust that you are already at work there. And by grace, you are doing a new thing. So do this new thing here in us. Do the new thing that we desperately need to happen, though we're not exactly sure what that is. Pull us into your new future. Push us. May we be used in any way that gives glory to you and for the edification of your people and for the redemption of the world. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Church, I invite you to receive this benediction. As we go from this place, in the power of the Holy Spirit, may God open our eyes and our minds and our hearts to see every person that we come in contact with as a beloved creation of the Most High God, who God calls precious and clean in his sight. Let us go singing his praises this morning. Grace and peace. You are dismissed.